Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to another session of the Bridge Live. Hope you guys are having an amazing Sunday. So I'm your host, Imtiaz, today. And since you all know that Olympics 2020 would have happened this time in this year, but due to the coronavirus pandemic, the sports ecosystem has suffered a lot. And as a result, Olympics has been like tentatively scheduled to 2021. So just to fill that void, we have brought this session called Not the Olympics, where we discuss and analyze India's chances at the Olympics had they played this year. So today we don't have any players or coaches with us. Instead, we have some super fans of Indian Olympic sports. So they have been following the Olympic sports for like probably a long time. And from hockey to athletics, they have been following it a lot. So please welcome our panelists today. So first we have Kapil Chaudhary.
Hello.
Like an expert analyst of Indian sports, and you can see his Twitter account, and he has been always tweeting about Indian sports. He wanted to become an athlete and represent India someday, but he's instead he's an IIT and IIM graduate and dabbling in his banking. And you can see follow his Twitter account, he's available at Kapil@8857. Then we have with us Vaibhav Manoja. So he's based out of Gurgaon, and he's into consultancy firm. So he follows Olympic sport for a decade now. And besides that, he's a big Rafael Nadal fan and also a Liverpool fan. So, I am also a Liverpool fan. So I would like to discuss about with you how did
good
you
to know that? Yeah, definitely.
How do you celebrate Liverpool's triumph this year? Okay, and then we have with us Mr. Madhusudan Rangu. He is based out of Mumbai and works with HDFC Ergo. So he is of MBA in finance, and he follows sport, all the Olympic sports like weightlifting, wrestling, and then swimming. And others. And last but not the least, we have Haripriya with us. Haripriya is my colleague at college, and he's one of the brains behind all the content that you see on our page. So as far as I know her, she's into tennis, and she also idolizes Rafael Nadal. So hi everyone, welcome to the
Hello.
Show.
Hey.
Thank you.
Yeah. Hi. Morning.
Thank you for taking out your time in the Sunday. Yeah. So what brings us here today is our shared interest towards Olympic sports and our love for the sports. So I would like to know from all of you that when did this started? When did this all started, when your love for Olympic sport began? So I would start with Kapil.
Yeah, so for me, it has been right through childhood. I mean, my dad was also a sports fan, a huge sports fan, or is a huge sports fan. And it was a way to connect with him as well. And I also used to enjoy a lot. So I think I remember watching the 1992 Barcelona Olympics just a little bit. But I think the first Olympics I really watched was 96 in Atlanta. And I remember watching Muhammad Ali lighting the flame. And even though I didn't really know who Ali was at the time, and then following Leander Paes. And I, in fact, remember I celebrated that Leander won the bronze when he had just won the quarterfinal, because I thought both semifinalists got the bronze. And then I found out that there's a bronze match as well if he loses to Agassi. And then, so it gave a double celebration. So I've been following rights in that. And it's just been increasing since then. Because, you know, now we have a lot more avenues to follow the sport. Earlier, we had just DD Sports and the newspapers. So, yeah, so that's the way. And it's really grown a lot, and I realized I would say a lifelong dream when I went to Rio in 2016, and I hope to be at Tokyo as well.
So, Vaibhav, what about you?
I think it's similar for me, just that we had shifted to a new place wherein, you know, we got a new cable connection, and that is when the two channels, Star Sports and ESPN, came for the first time. Hmm. I think it was around Sydney Olympics, a few months before that. So, I used to watch ESPN Star Sports all the time, used to read, you know, the sports pages of the newspaper. And that is when I think it was about Ian Thorpe, who had so much hype around him. I was watching Sydney Olympics and, you know, he was all over the place. He used to come on the ESPN, he used to be on the newspapers. So that is where my interest grew for the first time. Then I think Karnam Malleswari happened, and it was such a pride moment, you know, first woman from Indian India to win an Olympic medal. So as long as I can remember, that was the first love affair for me when it comes to Olympics. And then it gradually increased, you know, year on year, Athens, Beijing. But for me, I would also say that the turning point of, you know, significantly growing it was when I happened to join Twitter in around 2012-13. That is when, I think it was after London Olympics only. That is when it grew manifold. I met likes of Kapil, Madhuji, you know, later on Priya as well. And the kind of arguments, the kind of discussions we used to share on Twitter. So I think that just added on to the entire experience. And that is where I think I took it to the next level in terms of my interest in Olympics.
This is your next.
Yeah, yes. I think my story in a way is very similar to what Vaibhav said now, but it's just, you know, you just need to prepone it probably a decade ahead, because I'm much older than the other three much younger super fans here. Just as how Kapil and Vaibhav said during the initial days of Doordarshan, you know, the first my first recollection of watching the Olympics was the 1984 Los Angeles Olympics. You know, it was pretty early in the morning. I think it was late in Los Angeles, and you know, just while watching the opening athletes just walking around, then seeing the huge contingent from the US, and then watching the Indians going through. It you know, it's a lot of, I would not be wrong in saying that it used to give me a thrill at that time itself. But of course, those were the days when, you know, most Indian children, they were just glued to cricket. You know, the days of Sunil Gavaskar and Kapil Dev and Vengsakar. Yeah. And then moving over to the Seoul Olympics in 1988, yeah. You know, I don't recollect much of the sporting action, but you know, that Olympics, one thing stuck out in my mind was me waiting for quite some time to see the 100 meter men's final between Ben Johnson and Carl Lewis. You know, those two guys were way ahead. And then just, you know, that was my first live race of watching these athletes, you know, who were so very different from the kind of sportsmen that I used to see here, you know, in the sports in India, you know, just in those shorts and bronze muscled and rippled bodies. And then I saw that race of Ben Johnson he actually blew the entire field, and that figure of 9.83 stuck in my mind for a lot. Of course, you know, we all know what actually happened later, but that's a different story. Then after that, you know, I sort of went cold. I don't really recollect much of 1992 or 1996, but I do actually recollect that during the 90s, there's one athlete which stuck in mind, was a very short and diminutive weightlifter from Manipur, Kunjarani Devi. I think during that time, she was the best athlete. And of course, she won a lot of medals at that level, at the Commonwealth level. I'm not too sure whether she won medals at the world level, but the big lift up came, you know, as Vaibhav said and Kavapil said, Karnam Malleswari happened in a sport that is, you know, quite rare to a place like India. You know, weightlifting is something which is not really heard of, not really seen on the streets. It just happens in some remote corner. But that was the one, and you know, it was really great fun. And I thought at that point in time she could have won more than a bronze. Maybe there was a miscalculation in one of the lifts that she took. But then but then no worries. I think that changed things for us. And 2008, we could not see much of the Olympics, you know, it was not being telecasted at that time. But one evening on the news channel, I think it was on the same day that Vijender Singh and Sushil Kumar, they both won their bronze. I may be wrong here, but they won the bronze on the back of Abhinav Bindra's gold. Yeah. And you know, all of us are certain seeing India picking up 3 medals in one Olympics, you know, that really changed things for me. Then in 2009, Vijender Singh again won a bronze in the World Championships. 2010 was a big leap up when we had the New Delhi Commonwealth Games. And that was a thing which really changed my view, and I started slowly moving out of the sport of cricket, started getting more and more interested in sports other than cricket. And the New Delhi Commonwealth Games was really good for us. You know, the way we swept the medals in the freestyle men's and ladies category, that was a great thrill to watch. And then the biggest achievement was you know, the Moscow Wrestling World Champs, where Sushil Kumar won the gold. I think that ranks as one of the highest achievements ever, according to me, for Indian sportsmen, beating a Russian in their home. I think so basically 2010 was the year which really changed things for me. That's all.
Thank you, Mirza. Haripriya, you can go now.
So after hearing all these people, now I feel like very, you know, very young and also inexperienced, because like I was in school actually when 2008 happened. So like I was in 8th or 9th, I think. So before that, there was World Cup in 2007, and I was so excited because that's after 2003, I was not even, you know, aware of things happening around me. So by 2007, I was like, oh God, there's a World Cup. I'm going to follow a World Cup. And then the Cricket World Cup. And we didn't even make the knockout, I remember. So that's when I was like, oh, I was so disappointed because that was the first event I saw. And then that's when, like, after that, it all started for me through newspaper, because as I said, I was like, I grew up in a village in my grandparents' place, so we didn't have that access to what sport. And also we knew that in back then we didn't have that much live telecast also. So I read through newspaper and Rafa, the Spain team won the Davis Cup that time. So the paper had this big image of Rafa being carried. So that's when I started following tennis. So from there, the 2008, you know, Beijing Olympics, like we used to see in news, like what is happening. And I remember coming from school and there was this, everyone was celebrating in my village and they were telling, okay, we got that first Olympic gold. You know, my grandpa even had a chocolate, like he had a box of chocolate and he was giving to people. So my grandpa was so much into sports. So that's when I was like, okay, I wanted to have real conversation with my grandpa. So I started watching sports from then. And it's very, you know, I don't know whether it's lucky or not, you know, to start watching Olympics and even in the first Olympics to see that individual gold, you know. For many people, I knew that in India, they didn't get that chance. So it was frustrating to watch Indian sports in a global event, actually. But for me, like 2008, it was very happy. It was happy memory. So it started like that, and 2012 we had a very successful Olympic. So you know, the sport gave me it's kind of like the sport kept me keep coming back, you know, like because it gave me like a lot of good memories from 2008 and 2012, and I didn't want to go into 2016 at all. It was like, I think, most disappointing for me personally. So after seeing two Olympics India doing so well, so yeah, it started for me in 2008.
Yes. Thank you, Rupia. So I would like to share that my interest towards Olympic sports came around 2012, and luckily it was the most successful Olympic for India. So I would like to also tell our viewers that you can ask any questions in the Facebook comment section. So one thing we know that since the Olympics has been cancelled right now, and there is still a chance that 2021 might host the 20-year Tokyo Olympics. But what would have happened if Olympics happened this year, and how would India perform? So I would like to know from all of you, like, what do you think, and how many medals, or like, who would be the star performers of this Olympics? So who would like to answer my question? Maybe Vaibhav, can you start with it?
I think first of all, I've always been an optimistic sports fan, and even after that, I think that, you know, a lot of times we talk about the breakthrough moments that keep on happening in Indian sports, but I think I genuinely felt that Tokyo 2020 was that moment waiting wherein we would have exploded, and I have my reasons, because look, it's as simple as that. Whenever we speak about the previous Olympics, we've always had very, very, very few, genuine medal contenders, whom we can call out as favorites. For instance, in Rio, we just had Jeetu and probably, let's say, Mirza Bopanna. But this time in Tokyo, almost every sport, we had genuine medal contenders and people whom we could have said that, okay, these are favorites to win. I can count it, that shooting we had 5 or 7. In wrestling, we had 3-4. We had a proper medal contender in weightlifting. And badminton, we all know, it's been a growing story, and we've been winning medals almost in every Olympics. So this time around, I thought that we had a huge chance to win around, let's say, more than 7 or 8 medals. And from there on, the Olympic movement that we have already been witnessing for the last few years, it would have exploded like anything. But unfortunately, we are where we are. And, like you said, it's still uncertain. We are not sure if Olympics are still going to happen next year or not, and, you know, how things pan out. But yeah. Tokyo Olympics, things were looking very, very north for us.
Yeah, I think I'll agree with Vaibhav there. I mean, 2019 for shooting especially was, you know, a real breakthrough, I felt, for India. I mean, before that, if you look at the shooting World Cups, we used to win a medal here and there. But in 2019, we just absolutely crushed it. It was something like 19 golds across 4 World Cups. And we topped the medal tally in all the 4 World Cups. And I think I had done some analysis. I don't remember the exact numbers, but it's like in the past decade or so, we have barely won like 3-4 golds or something like that. And we had 19 just in 1 year. So, I mean, it was at a completely different plane. So, I agree with that other point. That we really had about, I think, at least about like maybe about 10 to 12 genuine favorites who could have won medals. And we had even a second line of at least about, I think, about 20-25 people who are decent contenders. So if you take that 30-35 medal contenders, even if you, you know, account for all the uncertainties and everything, you lose something, you'll win something. I was also definitely expecting that out of about, you know, 30-35 contenders, at least we'll realize, you know, maybe 8-9 medals somewhere around that. And if you could break double digits, that would simply be awesome. So yeah, it was really exciting, and yeah, we all know what happened, but.
Just one thing I would like to add to Kapil's point. Like he mentioned, so there is this second string of athletes. Now, if you'll remember from Rio also, it was not our favorite athletes who won us the medals. It was Sindhu and Sakshi. Yeah. Sakshi Malik, who you can't even consider as the second string of athlete who, you know, probably has an outside chance of winning a medal.
I don't think anybody considered Sakshi a real medal prospect. So I mean, that was totally out of the blue.
So that way Sindhu still had an outside chance, and if you consider athletes who have an outside chance, we have those as well in abundance, so that gives a great hope.
What do you think, Haripriya? Like, who had the best this year?
For me, like, medal wise, I would go with them, but more than medal wise, I would say that this Olympics is more of like, you know, to see Indian athletes in various sports and to perform with more confident. You know, I haven't seen Indians like in a global event performing with that confident, like going in as a favorite and performing also. You know, and we saw that in recent times. I won't say Olympics is as equal to Commonwealth or Asian Games, but still, when you see at 2018 Commonwealth and Asian Games, we have seen people who's like performing with more confidence. You know, we I don't know, like people loved Hima Das because of her confidence level, the way she was like, you know, put herself in the stadium, in the starting lineup. So I think that's what makes me, I wanted to look forward in this Tokyo Olympics, you know, to see PV Sindhu going into as a world champion, like what, how she's going to carry herself in the tournament, because we all know that 2016, it was not that, you know, she was favorite. Because Saina, the spotlight was on Saina, but I'm very sure that even when she go to Olympics, Tokyo Olympics, it's going to be PV Sindhu, who the spotlight is going to be there, and she's also the world champion. So I wanted to see how she's going to carry herself in the Olympics, as well as to see the shooting team, which is very young shooting team. And they performed, you know, under pressure, they have shown us that age doesn't matter. So, you know, last year in like, there was like, we saw in Commonwealth 15-year-old winning medals. And as well as like, when it's like, I personally thought that was like a one-time thing. But it kept coming back. You saw that they were performing so well in 2019 also. So I'm just waiting to see them, how they are going to perform in the big stages. Like Indians always, you know, they didn't have that confidence when performing in the big stages. And that, for that matter, I would say Sania and Rohan Bopanna, they really had a chance in Rio. I think they missed a golden opportunity. They were up a set and break in semis as well as in the bronze medal match. So even such playing that caliber, who usually plays in Grand Slam finals and things, but still they couldn't bring that confidence level to the Olympics, then just think about these younger players. So I wanted to see them how they perform in the big stages. So that was the one thing that I were looking forward to see in the Tokyo Olympics.
Madhusudhan, my question to you would be, like, we have seen that despite being in the pinnacle of success, suppose for instance Deepika Kumari or Jeetu Kumar, so we have seen that they are performing at the top of the league and like they are probably world ranking 1 and 2, and while going to Olympics we see a different story. They are often getting out of the race, the qualifying round. So do you think that we now know that we have some brilliant like shooters, we have the world number one boxer with us, we have then Bajrang Punia in wrestling. So what do you think that they would have created this, they would have ended the jinx this year?
Is it for me?
No, it's for Madhusudhan.
Okay.
Yeah, I think the last part of what you said, I could not hear it clearly. Can you just repeat, please?
So we have seen that players like Deepika Kumari or Jeetu Rai, they have been in the top of their world rankings, and despite that, they went to Olympics and didn't perform
Okay. I think
they have ended the jinx.
Yeah, I think so. Actually, what was really different about this time, 2020, if it would have happened, was we had at least about 8 or 9, taking into account the unpredictability of sport, we had at least probably 8 or 9 candidates who were as close to a shot at any of the medals, if not gold, which was something not very visible in 2008 or 12 or 2016. What has actually changed, and especially if you took a good example of Deepika Kumari, who really seemed second to none as far as skills were concerned in her sport, but it was very visible during the 2012 London Olympics. I remember in the Lord's Cricket Stadium. The nerves really took over for her. If I'm not mistaken, during one of her shots, I could see the bow. Her hands were slightly, they were not really as still as they should have been. You know, it was a clear case of nerves which was there for her. And it is not that, she is not really performed at the top stage. I mean, if you take a look at Deepika Kumari's track record in the World Cups and the World Championships for her sport, for I think 5 or 6 years, she's been continuously in the final. She's been continuously in the top 8 of her field She's reached the final. She's won a lot of medals. But when you come here to the Olympics, we all know that it is that event which comes once in 4 years. And no matter what you do in the World Championships or in the Commonwealth Games or in the Asian Games or anywhere else, we people think that a person who succeeded at the Olympic stage is the best in the world. Personally, if you ask me, I'm not very sure about that, because in fact, I've had a chat with you guys also, that I've always felt that the depth in World Championships is much more than that what is there in Olympics. But then coming back to your question, Imtiaz, yes, if you take a look at the people like Hima Das, you know, take a look at the boxer Amit Pangal, and you take a look at Chopra, Neeraj Chopra. I find that, you know, they just don't seem to be affected by nerves at the big stage. You know, so that is where skills apart, I think they are all extremely good in their field. But if you take a look like somebody like Das or Neeraj Chopra or the boxer Amit, they just don't care who is in front of them. The target is just, if you're throwing a javelin, it has to go past 85 meters or 90 meters. It doesn't matter to Chopra what the big Germans are doing. I mean, you just take a look at the 2018 Under-20 World Championships, the way Das ran that final. Halfway through that final, she was probably fifth or sixth. I still remember the commentator mentioning Hima Das has gone for a very conservative approach. These were the very words that were used by that lady. And when she reached the 300 meters, the way she shifted gears, I mean, from 300 to 310 or 320 meters, she just killed the field. I mean, in a world championship final, if you can take it easy till 300 meters and then just kill the opposition at the very end, I mean, it just talks to the mindsets of the people these days. So I think not just this Rio or the Tokyo Olympics. I mean, if it is held the next year also, you know, it's going to be a huge moment for Indian sports. And if luck goes their way, if they are able to control their nerves, I think they might go beyond even 10. I think for the first time, it might be even 11 or 12. And this taking into account, I feel that some of the medalists who have won in 2016 are not in the best of their form. Sakshi Malik is one, PV Sindhu is another. In fact, the entire badminton contingent has been struggling for the last 2 years. And we probably thought, at least I thought, when Srikanth won those four or five titles in a row in 2017, you know, at that point in time, Indian badminton was really on the way up. No, we got those titles from Srikanth. Sindhu, as usual, was always there in the back end of any tournament. But track record in the World Championships is really a sight to behold. Even after taking into account that the 2016 medalists have faded away as of now, I think 2020 Tokyo looked really good, really, really good.
I actually have a bit of a different opinion about this nerves argument. I mean, I personally feel that I don't think we ever had the kind of caliber going into any Olympics as we would have had at Tokyo. I mean, we have talked a lot about Deepika Kumari, and I know Deepika Kumari was the official world number one going into London. But personally, I think if you look at the results, I don't think Deepika Kumari was the objective best player in the world ever. Even going into London, I think... a fair world ranking for her would have been somewhere around 8 or 10 or something like that. And she basically was world number one because that's the way World Cups work. And, you know, Koreans, for example, they like to rotate their archers and they don't get that many world ranking points. And, you know, the thing is, in India, we have a big deal about this world ranking. But really, I personally feel besides, you know, sports like tennis and badminton, world ranking is always, you know, you should take it with a pinch of salt. Because you don't have so many events and the top players always, you know, often just rotate their events. So world ranking can often be misleading. And so even I think going into London, while Deepika was definitely a great contender, I don't think she was the best player in the world at that time. All the Koreans were ahead of her. The Chinese were, you know, were very strong. So it definitely, her performance in London was disappointing. But yeah, I still don't think she was the best in the world. And I think going into Tokyo, we definitely had a lot of players who are the genuine best in the world. So, I mean, if you ask a neutral today, for example, that, okay, who is the best in boxing in Amit Pangal's category? You will either pick Amit Pangal or you will pick the Uzbek guy. You will either pick Amit Pangal or you will pick Uzbekistan. So he was like the top, one of the top two guys in boxing. Bajrang Punia, okay, he struggled a little bit, you know, towards the end of, in the second half of 2019. But if in early 2019, going into the World Championship of 2019, if you ask a neutral and you pick one guy to win gold, it would have been Bajrang Punia. Similarly in shooting, you know, if you ask anybody, you pick one person in 10-meter air rifle movement, it would be Apurvi Chandela. In 10-meter air pistol, it would be Saurabh Chaudhary. I don't think we ever had this kind of caliber going into the Olympics. And that's why I was really excited about Tokyo. I mean, nerves and all are fine. They will always affect. And that's why the idea was, you know, if we have like good 30-odd contenders, at least it will translate to like 7-8 medals. So I just felt it was a different plane. I don't think we can really compare it with the previous Olympics.
I think more than the world ranking, probably what Madhuji is trying to highlight here is it's the mental block we often talk about our Indian athletes, right?
Absolutely.
That was for sure a case with Deepika, and in the Netflix documentary that she has, she herself says that there was so much hype around her that Indian media had created. She was under immense pressure while going into London Olympics, and she just couldn't tolerate that much of pressure. So I think that cutting edge winning attitude is a little more profound in the present day athletes as opposed to what it used to be in Beijing Olympics or London Olympics.
Kapil, what I totally agree with you that world rankings are not really a benchmark or a yardstick to decide who is the best or who is not, because it also depends, as you very rightly said, on the number of tournaments that the people actually participate in. But for me, to be very frank, you know, whether a person is world number one or a person is world number five or world number eight, for me, they are just the same. I mean, if you just take for example, the ladies badminton. I mean, if you just see the top eight or nine players, if you take a look at Okuhara, you take a look at Carolina Marin or our own very PV Sindhu, it really doesn't make any difference if they are two, four or five. You know, they all have tremendous past track records. But ultimately, what boils down is how they perform on that particular day, the day's luck, their day's mood, or you can call it by any name. But for me, you know, if a person wins a gold, I mean, I don't consider him much greater than a person who's come fourth. I mean, I know that it could just be just one inch or one centimeter, or just that, you know, the ball just landed half an inch outside the court. So, I mean, they're all great. I mean, equally great. It's not...
Yeah, I agree with you, Madhu, there. Only...
Yeah.
No, I agree with you, Madhu, there, that, you know, the top 8-9 people in most sports, they will be, you know, very close to each other.
Yeah.
But but that's the point I'm trying to make. So, it's like if you have 9 people who are all equally good and only 3 of them are going to win a medal, so that's a 33% chance of winning a medal. So, now when you look at, let's say, London Olympics, you have, let's say, one Deepika Kumari who's in the top 10, okay? And she doesn't come up with a medal. But she still had only a 20-30% chance of winning a medal. It wasn't as if she was the favorite. And obviously, there is some difference between, you know, the best in the world and, let's say, someone who's 5th or 6th. Not much, little bit here and there. But at least some difference is there. So, I'm just saying that, you know, there is this entire narrative that Indians do very well at non-Olympic events and then go and struggle at the Olympics because of the nerves. I have a problem with the first presumption itself, that Indians do very well at the non-Olympic events. If you actually look at all non-Olympic events, you have 4 World Cups. If you win one medal in one of the 4 World Cups, it doesn't mean you are the best in the world or, you know, if you're the favorite for the Olympic medal, because you just won one medal in one out of 4 World Cups. There are other 12, you know, if there are people who won multiple medals in the World Cups, they are the favorites for the Olympics. And that's what we had this time, which we haven't had in the past.
One of the best examples that I remember at this point of time is 2016 Olympics. Yogeshwar Dutt was billed as a Olympic medal hopeful. And why? Just because he had won the Asian Games gold medal. He had absolutely nothing to show in his CV in terms of world tour, but still he was billed as a favorite. That does not mean he was the favorite.
Exactly. I agree. And I remember, you know, I remember discussing with my sister and with my other friends as, you know, what are the chances of Yogeshwar in the Olympics? And I basically said, I have no idea because the guy has not competed in the world events. He might be very good. He might not be that good. I don't know because he's won the Asian gold. That's great. Even the Asian Games gold, he had won when Iran had skipped out on this category. But then there is a point that, okay, Iran's wrestler was maybe not that good. So, but he was a contender for sure. But how good he was, we didn't know because he hadn't competed on the world stage.
Yeah.
What do you have to say about the Sindhu's chances this year? So, because like he has been a world champion and apart from that, she's not consistent for the last few months. Real chances this year.
I think I would like to say she's never been consistent, first of all, on the world tour.
Yeah.
It's just
yeah.
that it's the main events where she, you know, comes up to her best, and her chances were as good as her chances were in 2019 World Championship or 2018 World Championship. On it's not about that.
Yeah, I think
Weber
put that very well. Sindhu is an enigma.
Go ahead, Aditya.
Yeah, so I personally love people who could perform in the big stage. So that is why, like, for me, PV Sindhu is someone, you know, she, even in the early stage, her biggest achievement was the World Championship bronze medal. I remember, like, 2013, I think. So even before all these super series and everything, it was, like, World Championship she peaked. So I really love those players who knows where to peak. You know, there are the champions who knows in which time they should give their full potential. You know, that is what make you you know, stand alone other than other players. So I feel like PV Sindhu is like one step ahead whenever you see with other Indian players. So I'm just I won't be surprised if she knocked out in the first round or second round. But I'm happy that if she can go on win the medals. Like, you know, you don't have that much expectation on her, but somewhere inside you knew that she can pull you that a big win. So PV Sindhu, for me, like I would give 90% chance for her because like a personal favorite thing. But other than that, I'm very happy if she couldn't make that. Because this is a player which we are talking about who can keep on giving us consistent performance only in the big stages. I'm just saying because we know how inconsistent she is in other things. But I'm okay with that. Because, see, when Kapil told that the mental thing doesn't matter, I personally feel that it matters. Because for me, we all know that in 2016, the draw and everything, the way Sania and Rohan went into the Olympics, it kind of made sense that these two had a real chance of getting a medal. But, you know, the way they performed, like in the match, when you see the semifinals match, you were up and set and the break, you should have been in the finals already. But you couldn't. And you just take the amount of experience these two guys carry, like Sania and Rohan Bopanna. And just leave out the Rohan Bopanna. Like Sania, she has played some good matches before. And, you know, Rohan, these both, when they put together, maybe it's because they two are playing for the first time or I don't know. But, you know, when you got that big stage and you know that you have the capability, I think you should go ahead and you need to win that medal. So back then, I think we never had this bunch which had this confidence. As Madhusudan, he just put it right. Like this particular bunch, they are very confident on themselves. More than, you know, I'm not sure whether Hima was that confident when she went into 2018 Asian Games, like thinking she could beat Nasir. But she's still confident there, you know. She stands there, she makes us to believe that, yeah, she can pull up. So that is what makes this bunch much different from the old ones. You know, you don't have this may or may not say that these people have confidence. That is good to see. That is one thing I started liking from these people, this new generation of our Indian contingent. And PV Sindhu is a front runner in that. She has proved time and again that she could go in and do some special things in the world stages.
I just want to add one last thing, which I feel is important since we are on this topic, just to ensure that, you know, we keep our expectations in check. I think one thing that is different for this Tokyo Olympics when it comes to badminton and Sindhu winning a medal in a high-level tournament is that we need to consider that Olympics are happening in Japan. So it's home conditions, slow-playing courts for both Okuhara and Yamaguchi. And whenever there are home conditions, especially in a tournament such as Olympics, that is always advantageous. So we need to keep that into consideration while, you know, assessing Sindhu's chances.
I think when you see in a neutral perspective, when you see as a neutral perspective, I think these two have a better chance to be in the finals, actually.
Okay.
Vaibhav, I mean, that point you raised about home crowd advantage, don't you think that's that can also be a double-edged sword? I mean, if you are playing in front of your own home crowd, it actually depends on player to player, right?
Also, those are slow courts, which in a way favor both of their games.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, that is a good point. Yeah, the slow court point is a very good point.
I just read somewhere, I mean, I'm not an expert in this, but I think somebody was mentioned that the slow courts will also suit our PVS. It will suit her style of game also.
It does because see, first she has an attacking game, so that way it might not suit her that well also. But she has a lot of physicality as well in her game. Like we have seen her matches against Okuhara, she has that stamina, she has that physicality where, you know, the endurance level, she can last longer in the games. But on a bird's eye view, it should favor more Okuhara and Yamaguchi, and they've shown this thing in their performances over last few Japan Opens, right? So that's right. Something that we need to consider.
I think the issue is that only, you know, I think Sindhu is maybe a bit of a unique Indian athlete in that sense that, I mean, I can't remember another athlete who is so much better in the big events as compared to the regular events. You can pick a cricketer like Shikhar Dhawan or somebody, but individual athlete at least, I don't remember anybody else who is just so much better at the world events, at the Olympics and the absolute marquee events. But in the regular events, she does struggle a bit. So she is a bit of an enigma. And in her case, that's why, because of that, it's very difficult to predict how she'll turn up in Tokyo. I mean, the only thing I'll say is that her final was one of the first things I put on my schedule.
I just realized that you're itching to move on to the next question. But before that, I just like to ask my friend Vaibhav here, that this point of, you know, the World Championships and Olympics being the big events, we have also deferred on Twitter. But that discussion I would like to have. Well, I'd like to have one-on-one with you, where somebody doesn't perform for 3 years and you say that doesn't affect her confidence. We need to discuss that on another platform. I think one-on-one.
Done. Sindhu, as it is, has been our favorite topic, if I remember correctly.
Exactly. I think Sindhu, correct.
Yeah.
Correct. And that's why I was a bit worried when Priya said that I'm giving 90% chance to Sindhu. I got scared that you might explode. We need to keep in mind Priya and Kapil and Imtiaz that when we talk of Sindhu in front of Vaibhav, it should always be 100%.
No.
Thanks.
Okay. Keeping the technicalities aside, we know that the Olympics has been delayed to 1 year now, and like the form that our players have, do you think they will be retained the same form? And we know that the fact that we have invested a lot in like developing our players' morale, we have like a good psychologist in every team probably. So, do you think that they will be able to retain the same thing in 1 year later? I would like to ask Haripriya first.
It depends on how many tournaments they could participate before the, you know, going to the Olympics. And because there are certain sports which gives you opportunity to play in the world stage a lot of time than the other sports. So, those are the sports I'm just worried. Because there are certain sports which we tend to participate only just before the Olympics. Like for 3 to 4 months, we just go and participate. So I think those are the sports which makes me I'm worried about those sports, because how they are going to keep up that you know, fighting spirit and the competition things. And so other than that, other sports, I feel it should be same as ever. But it depends on how many tournaments we are going to have before the Olympics. If Olympics is going to happen in July, I think by Jan, people should get back to the competitive circuit. Only then we can predict that, okay, how they are and what they are going to do. So I'm a hopeless person at this point of moment, whether Tokyo is going to happen or not. So if it is happening, I just wanted Indian or the world stage, like the game should start by Jan.
Then Kapil, can you please speak about
it? I think this is, you know, a very difficult question to answer, because I'm definitely not as confident as Haripriya that we can maintain a form. I'm not saying we will not maintain a form. I'm just saying that this situation, this entire COVID situation, is just like a once in a century situation, and it is very difficult to predict what will happen after that, because, you know, everybody has been in a different state. So there are people abroad, you know, who have already started training, who maybe were struggling going into Tokyo, who think, okay, this is a great chance that, you know, we can now get back fitness and, you know, work on ourselves and maybe come back stronger for 2021. There'll be others who are, you know, really excited to go into 2020, who might lose heart and it might be difficult to come back from that. So it is just such a once in a lifetime or once in a century situation that it's very difficult predict what will happen. And I think only when the competition start can we see what will happen. The hope is if some of us you know, suffer due to this lockdown, there'll be others like maybe a Saina Nehwal or a Shrikant who are struggling going into Tokyo, who might, you know, take the opportunity and improve going into 2021. But yeah, I think it's definitely a major issue. So only when the competitions will start will we know how this entire break has affected them, because it will affect everybody individually and everybody differently.
Okay. One of our viewers have asked, how many Indian athletes do you expect to peak at the Olympics next year? And will Saurav Chaudhary be the one of those? Who would like to answer this?
Well, I think Saurav was in a lot of momentum when he was shooting regularly in the competitions in 2019. But then, like, it's a very tricky answer to give, because shooting in itself is such a highly unpredictable sport that you can't predict a lot of patterns emerging out of it. And yes, Saurabh has that caliber, he has all the talent, and, you know, he's been shooting very highly consistently. But there cannot be a definitive answer to this.
Yeah, I actually think, yeah, Saurabh has a great chance. I mean, I think when you say, will Saurabh peak? I mean, I think, I don't know what is more, how much more can he peak? Because he's already, you know, creating world records. That how high can the peak be? So I don't know if he can do even better than he's already doing, because he's already shooting at such a great level, or he was shooting before the lockdown. But yeah, I definitely hope that he can maintain his form. And, you know, that's one of the things you worry, that, you know, whether this break will negatively affect him. But okay, we are not sports insiders, we are just fans. So from what we hear, it's like, he's generally a guy who stays in his own mind and doesn't take too much pressure, and he's not really worried about what is happening in the rest of the world. So if he can just, you know, maintain that, let's say, zen state and just continue doing what he's doing, he's definitely one of the, probably might just be the number one pick of ours, and might even actually, okay, I should not probably say that, but yeah, he can do great wonders at Tokyo if things just go the way they were going in 2019.
What about the players who were...
Yes, can I add to that?
Last performance at the Olympics. So I would say, suppose Leander Paes was there, and like probably Sania Mirza was there. So what about them?
Yeah.
Okay, Madhuji wanted to add something.
Yeah, go ahead.
Intias, can I just add to what Vaibhav, Priya and Kapil said? I think a point to be noted here is the age profile of the Indian contingent. At least if you take a look at the 10 or 12 medal contenders that we generally tend to agree upon, probably the eldest among them is, I think, Bajrang Punia and Vinesh Phogat and Mirabai Chanu. They would be 26, 27 types, you know, when the 2021 Olympics come about. And that, I think, is a very big big plus sign for us. These guys are young. They have not tasted blood at the top level. In fact, Vinesh Bogat came quite close last time. Unfortunately, she had that injury, and Chanu was one of the top four or five lifters at that point in time. So I think they are just going to be even more hungrier in 2021. But for me, apart from these guys, two guys who I think will come out much stronger in 12 months' time is the Indian weightlifter Jeremy Lalrinuga, if I got his surname right. Now, this guy is a huge talent from a guy who was lifting in the 50 kilogram category in the Youth World Championships in 2015, from about 240 kilos to having ramped up his body weight to 67 kilos and now lifting in the range of 306-307. And in fact, he's lifting at par with people who are one weight category above, at least in India. This guy, this 12 or 14 month time that he is going to get. I mean, he may not get into a medal bracket as yet for the 2021 games, but I think he could be in the top 8 or top 10. I know that there are two or three Chinese who are at the moment lifting about 25 to 30 kilos in front of him. But still, I think this guy could really change the face of Indian weightlifting, at least from the point of view of the men. And as far as Chanu is concerned, I mean, even as of now, with probably only one Chinese allowed to lift in that category maximum due to the quota restrictions. And if she stays injury free, unlike what happened in 2018, these are guys who I think will be just as strong and fit in 2021. And also my mind goes back to Chopra, who has just come back from such a huge injury. I think this 1 year gap could be something great for him. Of course, as Kapil and Vaibhav said, and Priya said, that it all depends on how the training actually goes from here on. Like, for example, Neeraj Chopra was training somewhere else abroad, and he had to be called back to Patiala, and he was to train here in the month of April and May for 8 to 10 weeks. I don't really know what really happened with that. So it's really tough. I mean, but for me, personally speaking, all things being equal, I think maybe our guys will be just as good to go in 2021, because the issues faced by our athletes is probably being faced by athletes throughout the world. So we might still be on the same plane as the other guys. I mean, whatever information I have.
Thank you. Okay, so we are already in 50 minutes of this live session and we are running short of time. So I would straight go into a debate that who has been the greatest Olympian for India, and what would, like, if you could share your opinions. I would like to start with Kapil.
Yeah, for me, I think it's difficult to look past Abhinav Bindra. I think his gold was it didn't register as much with me in 2008 as it does now. In 2008, it seemed like another medal. But, since then, two Olympics have gone and nobody has been able to do what he did. And also, he was the first medal of Beijing, which eased out the pressure on the others as well. So, I don't know if it directly helps, but I think it would have helped Vijender and Sushil a little bit that, at least that first medal is out of the way for India. So, yeah, for me, it is very difficult to look past Abhinav Bindra. Yeah, it has to be.
Madhusudan?
Yeah, me?
Yeah.
Okay. See, for me, I won't be as clear as Kapil, but I think all the guys who have won medals for us, I would actually put them on the same platform. Abhinav Bindra, right, because he's not only been the first individual gold medalist, but it seems that his sport itself has gone to another level. I think his contribution is not just restricted to the gold medal, but it's also where we see that sport there today. But having seen that, I would go to my other favorite sport, freestyle wrestling. That sort of credit should also go to Sushil Kumar. I mean, I'm not a great fan of what he has done over the last 4 years, but from 2008 to 2016, I mean, he has done wonders. But in India, there's a strange problem. I think it's with our culture or upbringing. We tend to, keep different sports at actually different levels. You know, it is like, you know, somebody like if he's done well in cricket or lawn tennis, if his achievements are on par with somebody in the field of wrestling or boxing, you know, we tend to give more glory to the person who has done well in tennis or cricket. There seems to be some issue that, okay, this sport is only for the top people, for people above a certain class. Wrestling is a sport for people below a certain class. So they don't seem to get that kind of a credit, or at least the media doesn't talk about them the way they would talk about Abhinav Bindra or even a Leander Paes. Mind it, I have huge respect for Leander Paes for what he's done. I mean, 6 Olympics, 7 Olympics, and so on, and still good for another. But I think, we need to give credit to all the people, and my heart would go to Kumar. Two Olympic medals, 1 World Championships. He's been a junior world champion long time back, which I don't think too many people know. So, but yes, even the sport of wrestling, I think, is finally making a change. But I think more than Kumar, that credit has to go to the movie Dangal, which brought the field of wrestling to the common man's room. The hardships that the people actually go through in that sport, it is something which is seen to be believed. Kumar is my vote. Sushil Kumar.
What about you, Vaibhav?
Well, I think if you're talking about the best Olympian in the history of the game, so I don't think we can look beyond a certain Dhyan Chand. Yes, I agree with both of them, Abhinav, and he's been the flag bearer of when it comes to individual sports. Sushil, of course, stands out. But so a few days back, I was preparing for a quiz. That is when I happened to read a few stories about Dhyan Chand. And like, it's incredible the level of, results Indian team was able to churn out under his leadership. Just for instance, I think it was his third and last Olympics, the Berlin Olympics, when he won his third gold, and I'm sure everyone would have heard of that story where Hitler asked him to check his stick just to see if there is a magnet included in that stick. So like, in that entire Olympics, Indian hockey team, which was led by Dhyan Chand, they conceded just one goal throughout the tournament, and that too in finals. So I think it's quite amazing the level of achievements he has had, and the level of hype, the level of world beater branding that he has managed to do. I don't think anyone else has done that ever in Indian sport, other than of course a few cricketers.
Iska screenshot kaise banega? Screenshot.
For me, it is Sushil Kumar, of course. So I think I had this discussion like very recently with Intiaz. Like, there is a poll going on in the best, and in the round of 16, Sushil was, it was like the first round. I'm not sure whether it's round of 16 or quarterfinals. It was the first round, I think. And Sushil was eliminated. And I was so furious that I was talking to Intiaz, telling like, like Sushil deserves better. For me personally, the two medals and world championship titles puts him much way better to any other players. And it's not easy after winning a medal and coming back and also being a favorite. I watched 2012 London Olympics, and to see Sushil dominate all those bouts and coming to the finals, it was like, even the sport itself, it's a compact sport, and the wrestling, the game itself, it's like more of like can see the dominancy itself. The shooting is not a sport because I grew up in a place like from 2008 when I saw like I didn't see the Abhinav Bindra's medal. Maybe that is why I am more into Sushil's medal. But for me, it's like two Olympic medals, and after being considered to Olympic medals matters a lot. Because after winning a medal and coming back with same hunger to win another medal makes so much sense for me. So Sushil is for me is the way to talk about it. And also like a special mention is like apart from where I come from, like from South, we are more attracted to track and field actually. So we tend to have this PT Usha is kind of someone who we look up to. So for us, it's like we knew that she didn't win any medals, of course. But the sport from here, when you look track and field, it's very different from South. When you take Tamil Nadu or Kerala here. So for us, PT Usha's that Olympic is still matters. And for us, maybe if someone like from PT Usha Academy, now we know Hima Das is there, but anyone from here, if they could go ahead and win that medal, I would say the track and field would have a different approach from there on. So for us, PT Usha is kind of as equal to any of the Olympic medalists.
For me, I would like to say the hockey.
I will just like to add.
Go ahead.
Yeah, in case you go ahead, then I'll just complete.
So I was saying that for me, I think the greatest Olympic moment is probably the domination by the hockey team. Like the way they dominated for the 7 or 8 Olympics was too good. So I was just good for them. Yeah, so Kapil, you were saying something.
Yeah, so I just wanted to add that, you know, when Imtiaz first sent us the agenda, and this was one of the questions which he said he'll be asking. And I was wondering myself, and actually the only contenders which came to my mind was Bindra, Sushil Kumar, and the hockey team represented by, let's say, Dhyan Chand or Balbir Singh Senior. So, I mean, I'm just saying it's good to know that those are the people that even the others saw. Because all of them have unique achievements. So obviously, the hockey team doing whatever they did in the 30s, and Bindra being the only individual gold medalist, and then Sushil being the only double medalist, double individual medalist. So, yeah, so I'm just happy to hear the opinions more or less match with what I was thinking. I went with Bindra, others went with others. That's all just personal opinion.
Madhusudan has something to say, I think. Yeah.
Yeah. Apart from, anyway, Olympics is something which has not been coming to our drawing rooms for too long, except for the last 3 or 4 Olympics or so. But along with the medals that we have won, the color of PV Sindhu's dress in the 2016 Olympics, I think she was wearing the yellow one. I think that was just as powerful and pleasing to the eye as much as the silver medal that was around them. I'm sure one of the panelists here is very happy. I can see him smiling.
So since we're running short of time, so this would be my last question. So assume that 2021 Olympics happen. Then what after that? In 2024, who will be the big stars to look out for? And like there are a lot of youngsters, they are shining right across. We have seen them performing really well in the junior circuit. So who will be your bet for 2024? Want to start with Madhusudan, why don't you start this time?
My first vote will go to Jeremy Laldrinoga. He'll be around 20 years at that time. Peak time for a young weightlifter. And with a gap of only, if I assume that the big Chinese are going to be at, if he's going to be in this weight category of say 67 kilograms, with the Chinese lifting, the best of them lifting at 333, he lifting at 306. Assuming things remain equal, he could bridge that gap by 2024. If you ask me to name one guy, it has to be him. Jeremy.
Okay. Haripia?
Expectation would be one medal in track and field somewhere. Please give me that one medal in 2024. Then the one guy which I really look forward is like...
That's 2021 also.
Maybe 21 or 24. But I'm not sure. Like I said, you right. 21 is not happening in my mind. Other than that, cycling is the one sport which I'm really looking forward to. Because recently to see these youngsters doing so good, Iso is there, and it's kind kind of very different, you know. I just wanted to start learning about cycling because I have never even imagined that someone from India who can perform that good in a world stage in that event. So I just wanted to see how this is going to transform from junior to senior circuit, because as far as any sport concerned in India, the transition between from junior to senior is not that good. We have seen in tennis like UT Bambri and people like that. So I just wanted to see how the transition goes, and even that goes for both Neeraj Chopra, Hima Das, how the transition happens. So Neeraj has been showing some good, you know, in the starting stage being good actually. So Neeraj, like that 90 meter is what we are waiting for last 1 year. So for me personally, cycling is the one event which I'm looking forward into 2024, and I could feel there's a lot of track and field athletes who can be in the world stage in 2024, because I spoke with Pravin Shravan, the youth Olympic medalist,
yes.
And he told me that how he is looking forward for 2024, and there is Sri Shankar is there, and so I just wanted to see how these athletes grew when the Olympic comes. But the one thing which really stands out is that I just wanted to say, like, so I spoke to 11 in Valerival, and it was like back in 2018. So after that, like in 2019, I remember I spoke to her before all these winning these medals and world number one, and she told me that I'm not looking 2024, I'm looking 2020. So that stood really, you know. Because for me, this athlete said 2020, and there is Pravin Chitrawal who told me that I'm looking for 2024. You know, the confidence level what this bunch has is like, I just wanted to put it out there. I know this is not relevant to the 2024 thing, but just that, the confidence level, and I'm looking for cycling.
Yes, actually, just to add on to Haripriya's point, I mean, I think if you just look at our top contenders going into 2021, most of them, we hadn't even heard their names in 2016. So, I mean, if you look at Manu Bhakar, you look at Saurabh Chaudhary, you look at Amit Pangal, you know, so many others. You look at Anish, okay, he's not the absolute top contender. But there are so many names which we hadn't even heard in 2016. And Rio also was similar to some extent. You know, okay, we had heard rumblings of PV Sindhu in 2012, but she hadn't really broken through. And nobody had heard of Sakshi even then. And in fact, you know, I'm actually just wearing this T-shirt with all the top Rio 2016 contenders, which I had got made for Rio 2016. And I look at it and I notice that only, you know, Sania Mirza might qualify. Deepika Kumari is there. And then there is Saina Nehwal who's struggling. And the hockey team is represented by Sheena. So if I look at the shirt, most of these people are either now retired or, you know, inactive or not really contenders for 2020. So from that perspective, I mean, I would say probably the biggest contender going into 2024 will be someone we have not heard of as yet. So that would be the ideal thing. But yeah, of the ones we have heard, the shooting team is all still very young, and hopefully they can keep going strong till 2024. Jeremy is a great point by Madhu as well. So of the ones we have heard, I think those are the top guys. But yeah, I'd really love to see some people whom we have not heard of yet.
Vaibhav.
Yeah, so I think I echo all of their thoughts. There might be a lot of newcomers whom we don't know as we stand at this point of time. There might be many young shooters who must be 17, 18 then, who are coming up. There's a huge bunch of swimmers who are teenagers, and you know, they are also coming up. But if I have to call out three names who are at top of my mind and, you know, personally in whom I would be invested in, so that would be first Lakshya Sen. I am very, very keen on, you know, tracking his journey and how he goes through from Tokyo to Paris, because I think that is worth investing. Second, again, Jeremy. And third would be Esau. Like Pia said, there's a momentum happening in cycling. So, and Esau has been doing incredibly well, you know, at world level, at his junior level. And it'll be a great thing to track his journey and, you know, see what he is up to. So, yeah, these three would be my top three contenders.
And actually, I'll just add one more name. I think Neeraj Chopra, I think he has great chances in 2021 as well. But I think his real Olympics should be 2024.
Absolutely.
2024 should be his Olympics.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. We have to wrap the session here. And thank you for joining us on a Sunday afternoon. It was really insightful to have all of you on our show. And so for viewers, we'll be back again with another episode of Bridge Live next week. And still, till then, keep following the bridge. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks for inviting us. And yeah, just one last thing, a huge shout out to, you know, you guys at Bridge. I think you guys are doing a wonderful job disseminating all the information about Indian sports. So yeah, all the best with that, and yeah, keep up.
I think the name that you use for your company, Bridge, I think it's the apt name. You're really trying to bridge the gap between the information flow from the sports people to the common man. So it's a really apt name that you're using. I've been in touch with one of your colleagues, Shubhro.
Yeah.
For a long, long time. I think it's been an association when he was in a different company also for the last 5 or 6 years. And I must thank him also if he's listening. He's given me a lot of opportunities to express my views on the World Wide Web earlier in a different company and even here. And thanks to Haripriya, Vaibhav, and Kapil. Three real, if you have to give medals to sports fans, gold, silver, and bronze, then I think it has to go to the three of you. Learn a lot from the three of you guys. And I think.
Thanks, Madhuji, you're being kind.
No. Yeah. I think if Vaibhav and Haripriya pick up the cue from Kapil and also write more, then it will be great, great education for all of us who follow you guys and Bridge. Really, thanks a lot to you three, and special thanks to you, India.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, thank you, everyone. It was fun.
Thank you, Madhuji.
Yeah. Thanks, India. Lot of fun.
Yeah. Bye. Good day.
So we'll be back with another session of Bridge Live next week. Till then, keep following the bridge.